Okay, so my name is Pablos. I work at a lab called Intellectual Ventures. If you guys, was anybody here last year? A few of you? Okay. So you remember what I was talking about last year? No. In part, you might remember this. So one of the things I wanted to do this year is show you what we're working on in the lab. And it's a pretty unique place. You can see here we're shooting mosquitoes down with laser beams because we thought it would be funny. And then we found out that we could possibly save some lives doing that. Malaria is killing about 1 million people a year in Africa. Half of them are kids. And this is our way of trying to do something about it. What's going on is we're trying to find ways to make invention into a legitimate career choice, right? Probably not a single person in this room has a business card that says inventor on it. Probably not even Dean has that. And we think that's wrong. What we think is that invention, it should be celebrated, and people should specialize in that and get really good at it. This is our lab where basically we hired one of every kind of scientist in the world. We bought one of every tool in the world, stuck them all under one roof, and started inventing crazy stuff like lasers for mosquitoes. And this is working really well. It turns out, by specializing, we're getting pretty good at inventing, and we come up with ideas that nobody else would come up with for all different kinds of problems. And part of the way we do that is we get the guy with the problem, and we stick him in a room and surround him with a nuclear physicist, a laser expert, a computer hacker, a chemist, and what we do collectively is try to know as much as we can about every area in science and technology so that we can cross-pollinate that stuff and come up with crazy ideas you wouldn't get working in the trenches. And we think everybody in the world should do this, but it turns out we don't have much competition because most big companies shut down R&D in the 80s, and most other environments, like universities, you don't have the same incentive to work with people from other areas in science or other disciplines and backgrounds. And so it's turned out to be pretty unique. So we've come up with some various stuff. I'm going to show you a couple of things we work on. Wireless communications right now, you all know, sucks because when you get the new iPhone, it's fast for like 3 days until everybody else gets the new iPhone, and then they're raising the noise floor for wireless, and what's happening is the little antenna in your phone is just broadcasting noise, getting in the way of everyone else. And so we're trying to figure out how to solve that in the long run. In satellite communication, as an example, you put a dish on the ground and you point it at a satellite and it's fixed. You don't have a satellite dish on your phone because it would be really hard to keep it aimed at the satellite. Well, we came up with a new technology using metamaterials that allows us to make a dish, which is actually just a flat panel, but it can electronically steer its beam. So you could put it on an airplane, you could put it on a car, you could put it on the back of a laptop or a phone, and it can steer its beam directly at a satellite or a tower and not interfere with everyone else around you. And this is a way that we can ultimately get, you know, gigabit wireless to everybody all the time. And so that's a kind of cutting edge area in science. Metamaterials are materials that don't exist in nature that have cool properties. And in this case, it's given us the ability to steer a beam. So in our lab, we have a culinary sciences group working on the science of cooking. And a lot of what chefs do is old wives' tales, traditions, but they don't necessarily understand the science behind what's going on in cooking processes. Well, we're trying to fix that. We have a kitchen with a drill press and a bandsaw and a pharmaceutical freeze dryer that costs more than a Ferrari, a rotary evaporator, all things that George Foreman will hopefully put in your kitchen someday. But our team, which consists of chefs from the best restaurants in the world and chemists, they're all spoiled now because they can't cook without a centrifuge. But what they've learned is lots and lots and lots about what's going on in cooking and how to optimize that. They printed a 2,400-page cookbook on the science of cooking. It's 6 volumes. It's the most expensive cookbook humans have ever made or probably ever will make because we're a little crazy. But in the process, they describe a lot of these things in ways that you can understand and the chefs can understand. And they've done a lot of cool photography like this where we cut kitchen tools in half in our shop so that we could show these cooking processes and you could understand them. We took about 180,000 photos to make this book, and it's pretty cool stuff. But now that they're done with the book, I've been repurposing this group to help me with the inventions around cooking so that we can improve this stuff and make food that's not only tastier but healthier and more efficient. One of the ways that we cheat at inventing is by applying computers to almost everything. And this is applicable for you guys. You can recognize that, you know, like for me, in the 80s, I would say preposterous sounding things like, someday you'll have a computer in your car, or someday you'll have a computer in your phone. And I sounded like a lunatic, and at the time it probably was, but we all take that for granted now, right? We know that's true. Computation has extended to the point where it's gonna be in everything. And what we do is we use a cluster of computers. We have a 5,000 core cluster in our lab, which we do epidemiological modeling on, which means as an intervention for malaria, which is something Bill Gates asked us to work on, we want to be able to test our ideas in software thousands of times before we ever do it in the real world. So this is computationally intensive stuff. 5 or 10 years ago, it would have been laughable to even try. But now we have a surplus of computing power. So what we do is we make a Monte Carlo simulation. That means we have this model of Africa. Here I'm just showing you Madagascar. We model rainfall, travel of humans, the climate, anything that can affect the transmission of the disease. And we do that over time, over the course of years. So you'll see here, we show for Madagascar, every pixel we have data for, we can show what's happening. And you can see the cases of malaria. This is the winter. And over the as you get into summertime, all that red areas is lots and lots of malaria cases. In the winter, it backs off again. That part in the center is the high ground, right? Mosquitoes don't live in higher altitudes, so you're pretty safe if you're up there. And what we're trying to show is that if we sprinkle some bed nets here or DDT there, we can see what happens over the course of years to the disease, right? And we can do that in software before we ever do it in the real world. And that's the kind of capability that computers are changing. We're doing this for epidemiology. You could be doing it for marketing programs, right? Every company in the world should be thinking about how does this computational modeling capability that we have now affect what we do, right? You could get rid of these simple algorithmic models like, you know, males 18 to 25 use so many condoms in a year and change it to this guy, age 18, uses this many condoms in a year. Let's give him the right coupon or whatever it's going to take. Make a marketing program for an individual. We can do all that now because we have a surplus of computing power. I worked on this project to try and figure out how to suppress hurricanes. Again, a problem that's a little too big for most people to bother with. What happens with hurricanes is they're fueled by heat irradiating off the surface of the ocean, right? Sun shines on the ocean, heats it up, that heat rises and fuels hurricanes. Well, if you could just cool off the surface of the ocean a little bit, you wouldn't have hurricanes that were so bad. That's, of course, a ridiculous notion because the ocean is really, really big. But it turns out everywhere you have this problem with hot water on top, you have cold water below. So if we could just stir it up real good, we might be able to stop hurricanes. Also a ridiculous notion because it takes so much energy to stir up the ocean. But again, coincidentally, we have a free source of energy right there where we have this problem, waves. Tons and tons of energy in waves that we normally don't care about because it's in the wrong form and it's not where humans are. Well, we came up with this really simple concept. The waves push hot water into a giant tube that we stick in the ocean. That yellow thing you see is an artificial beach, so waves crash over the top, and they add hot water to the top of the tube. That creates a pump, and the water gets pushed down below, a couple hundred meters below, where it mixes with cold water, right? It's basically a giant tube made out of like polyethylene, like a trash bag, some recycled truck tires to hold it up. There's no moving parts. And you put a couple thousand of these in the Gulf, and what do you know? You could maybe turn your Cat 5s into Cat 4s or Cat 3s. Huge scale project, I admit, but the kind of thing we might need to do because Hurricanes are getting worse every year, and people aren't doing a very good job of moving away from the coast. Which, of course, would be plan A. There's always a plan A that's not getting done. We just think, let's try and come up with plan B, or C, or D. So another plan C we've come up with is what to do about global warming. So it turns out that the sun, again, we never blame the sun, is heating up these greenhouse gases in our environment, right? A natural way of affecting that is when volcanoes erupt, they spit sulfur dioxide into the stratosphere and reflect a little bit of sunlight. So this is an artificial way of doing it. You've got a hose on giant triangular helium balloons, hauling the hose up to the sky, right? 12 miles up, aerosolizing sulfur dioxide to put out a tiny little bit of particulate up there that reflects some sunlight. Think of it as 1% of sunlight getting reflected before it gets into Earth's atmosphere. So we're finding an artificial way to replicate a natural phenomenon like a volcano. When Mount Pinatubo erupted in 1992, the temperature of the entire Earth was down about a degree for a year after that. And this was a very heavily instrumented geological event, so we know this. This is not a way to solve global warming at all, right? I said this is plan C. This is a way to maybe buy us a little bit of time while we transition off of the messy, dirty, ugly fuels we're using now, right? And these models will show a little bit. These are computational models again, but for climate models showing what's going on with the temperature in the Arctic. So the next one's good. So on the left here, the pink is what Arctic ice conditions should be on the North Pole. Blue is what we actually have today. That's showing what we could get if we deployed one of these hoses in the Arctic region, right? We restore Arctic ice conditions back to pre-industrial levels, right? We treat some of the symptoms for maybe a few decades, 50, 60 years or something, while we build more nuclear reactors and solar panels and wind farms and all those things. Speaking of nuclear, these are stainless steel casks left over from today's nuclear fuel enrichment program. Each one contains a bunch of depleted uranium, and we don't really have a plan for what to do with that stuff, so we put it in stockpiles. So this is a stockpile in Kentucky, 700,000 metric tons of depleted uranium sitting there. What you do is you dig uranium up out of the ground, you put it through this elaborate enrichment process involving centrifuges that terrorists are trying to steal, and you generate a fissionable material, so some enriched uranium. You get about 3% of the energy out when you do that. The other 97% sits in this stockpile right here, right? Perpetually, until kingdom come, we have no plan for what to do with that. Then you take that enriched fuel and you put it inside of a reactor or a bomb, and you get about 5% of that energy out, right? And that's okay because there's so much energy in nuclear fission that we don't mind being so wasteful. But the problem is, you know, we're creating this big mess. We're not getting a lot of fuel efficiency out of it. And we have this proliferation problem of people trying to steal enriched fuels, make bombs out of them. We have the other problem of just making bombs. And so what we do with that waste after we burn the enriched fuel is we have these fuel rods, highly radioactive, very dangerous stuff we're all totally scared of. We put it in a swimming pool next to the reactor. And we leave it there forever and ever and ever and hope that nothing ever happens to it because it's too scary to deal with, right? So we don't have a plan for that stuff either. So we invented a new type of nuclear reactor that runs on nuclear waste. What we do is we take that waste in the stockpile in Kentucky. There are other stockpiles, that's just one big one. And we put it in our reactor and we enrich it inside the reactor and burn it inside of the reactor. And so you never have a critical mass of fuel. I'll show you how this works. This diagram or this illustration sort of shows how nuclear fission works, which I'm sure you're all totally excited about and familiar with already. But basically, there's atoms and shit. Okay. what happens is you've got some uranium. It won't create a fission reaction. It won't sustain a fission reaction until it's enriched. That's what this green stuff is in our reactor. The red stuff is a little bit of enriched fuel. So like a candle, we light it up at one end. The leading wave enriches the fuel. That second wave burns the fuel. And from one end to the other over the course of about 60 years in our current design, right? So the entire time, you've only got a little bit of fissionable material. There's no moving parts. The thing can't explode or melt down in the way that a reactor today is capable of doing. There's no fuel rods that have to be swapped out, which is a really sensitive and dangerous part of today's reactors. And we figure, with the fuel I showed you in that stockpile in Kentucky in our reactors, we can power the entire planet, including growth, for about 1,000 years. And that's before we ever have to dig up any more uranium. So anyway, those are projects we're working on. That's the last I had to show. Thanks.